Hey, I'm Alex Radcliffe from Board Game Co., and today I'm reviewing Mega Man Adventures from Blacklist Games. And Mega Man Adventures is a cooperative experience where you're playing as Mega Man and his allies as you make your way through a variety of stages to eventually fight the bosses and hopefully take them down before you are taken down in turn. That's the basic core gameplay. Try to survive, take down the bosses, try not to die along the way. The core game structure involves you drawing four cards. You're going to be drawing four cards in order to work together as you go through the stages. Now, from those four cards, one will be your left support, one will be your right support, one will go down to your skill, and one is held in your hand as something you can discard to get an extra ability from it as we go. So, let's go ahead and go through these cards. I have these four cards over here. The cards you slot in your left and right support are incredibly key because you're going to be helping your allies in this game. So if you're sitting here playing this game, you're going to be playing down a card over here, and I'll pay attention over here. I see that player to my left, he has a little bit more yellow that he needs, so I'm actually going to slot this into my left support over here. I'll put that down over there, ignore the fact that there's not a lot of room in this cramped little camera space, but we have that over there as my left support, so I'll be able to get benefit from that, as will the ally to my left. On my right, I see that she needs nothing that specific, a little bit of red. I can't help her that much with red, so I'm just going to go ahead and give her, I'm going to look at the abilities in the bottom, and I'll go ahead and give her a blue. I'm not entirely sure, I'm not confident. I know I need it. She doesn't seem to need the blue, but it doesn't need anything that strongly past red when I don't have red. And from there, from these two cards, one will be utilized as a skill, and I'll go ahead and put that down over here. Doesn't really help me that much either, but we're going to utilize it as my skill over here. And then lastly, I hold on to our cards. So again, you draw four cards, you play your cards trying to be mindful of what you need, trying to be mindful of what your allies need as you play to your left and right support. All the other players are doing the same thing, and then from there you move into the actual phase. From there, I'm just going to go through Mega Man's adventure over here. I'm not going to go through everyone else's. I'll go through a turn as Mega Man so you can see how that plays out, imagining for a second that we have some, you know, support from over here. Let's put this as my left support because I will benefit from that. This table's getting very packed. I did not plan properly for this. We'll draw a card from here, and I'll utilize that yellow, and let's go through this over here. So, here's what we have. We have a yellow die over here that we're going to add to my dice. We have a yellow die from over here we're going to add to my dice. We have a blue dice that we'll add, and we have this symbol over here, which allows me to flip this token, which sort of acts like a die, because the dice, while each color die is primarily associated with one symbol type, either jumping, shooting, or running, it's not exclusive to that type, and you could roll other things. So I'll go ahead and roll my three dice over here. I also have a weapon I can utilize, as well as my skill, but we're going to start with these over here. I'm going to roll those, and that will give me two runs, a third run over here, and a shoot. Now, the problem with that is I don't actually need the shoot at all to get through anything. I might be able to use that in some other way. I don't know, but let's start with, I need a jump. I really need a jump, so that's the desperate problem over here. I might end up paying some energy to re-roll some dice. It might be the way to go. Or, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to start with this. I'll utilize my skill, where I can go ahead and convert one of these. I can spend one of these symbols in order to gain the other two. That actually might work well for me. So, that's going to be my first action there. My second action is, now that I have these symbols, I'll spend my jump, as well as one run, and I'll go ahead and complete this stage. So I'm going to move on to this stage, which requires a run and a jump, and I'll avoid the two damage that this stage would otherwise have given me. So I cleverly avoided that over there. From there, I have to get to the next stage. Now, the next stage is a bit of a problem, because the next stage requires two jumps and a time symbol. A time symbol can be paid for with anything that is any two of the same type, but it still leaves me a bit stuck here, because I don't actually have two jumps to work with. So I may have to sadly take three damage. My weapon over here will give me will let me activate the shooting over there, but that's not enough to actually help me. I could spend the two shoots to ignore the time symbol, but I'm still going to be stuck with the two jumps, and that means I might have to skip that stage. I have a blue I can spend here. I think I'm going to go ahead and discard the card from my hand to earn a blue die. So we're going to discard this card. Other players can also discard their cards to help me. I'm going to roll this blue dice. I got a run, which is not what I wanted at all. Not what I wanted. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to spend an energy to re-roll these two dice over here, hoping for some jumps. Beautiful. There we go. So, we have double jump. A double jump plus a double run for the time is going to let me sneak past that stage over there. I'll also earn a crate as a reward, which I'll draw, and that's going to give me one of these, which I already have that loaded up. And then from there, I'll spend my last run over here, this run over here, to move past this stage and avoid the damage. That is basically a stage in Mega Man. Trying to be mindful of what players have given you, trying to be mindful of the cards you've played, trying to be mindful of when you can discard extra cards from your hand to help someone out in a pinch, either yourself yourself or your allies, be utilizing your weapons, which will require an energy to use, but they can give you other boosts as well. And that's basically what you're trying to do. Go through a bunch of stages and eventually start tackling the bosses, which functionally are fairly similar, but are slightly different. Now, a few things before we get to the bosses, something I skipped for the sake of just giving you that walkthrough, is you're going to have stage rules. So for example, Iceman over here, if we're facing Iceman, we have the dice pool where if two or more dice show at least one run, we suffer a damage. So these stage rules are going to give you different things you have to take into account in addition to the basic survivability of the stage. When you're done with the stage, you move to the next round, you go ahead and complete the next stage, that's variable depending on the player count, how many stages you're going through, and then you make your way to the boss, where we're going to go ahead and take one of these bosses, and the boss is going to give you some specific weakness, some specific count of how many stages they're going through, which weapon types they're weak to, and then we're going to grab a few boss cards, and you're going to go through a similar stage, but slightly different than the three stages we just went through here. Instead, you're going to be shuffling these up, and then starting to draw one stage at a time. Same basic sequence otherwise, though. You're going to go through a stage, have those symbols, or take that damage, go through that, the skull symbols related to the boss. Every boss has a different version of what the skull symbol means. In this case, it's adding a time element, so that's going to be a little hard to go through, and that's basically how you play Mega Man. Draw four cards, assign the four cards in a way that is most beneficial in helping you survive through the stages without taking any damage, and then try not to die, because when you die, you will have a limited number of these to cash in to refill your life back up, and once you aren't able to do so, well, you're going to die at that point. A few other things to mix it up. There's a full solo experience in it as well. I have not played it solo. We'll cover that shortly. There are all these difficulty cards you can start adding in that give you different elements. You can add as many of them as you want. If you find the game to be too simple of an experience, you can start adding these to modulate the difficulty and give you more of a challenge every single time. And that is basically Mega Man Adventures. Mega Man Adventures, that's the name of the game. So, review time. Starting off with ease of play. The game itself is actually fairly easy. It's a fairly easy game to teach, to get people up and running. I will say the rules are actually a little verbose considering the amount going on in the game. This is a game I can get you up and running in 2 or 3 minutes, especially because it's cooperative. I can give you a few rules, get up and running, and you'll get a good feel and sense for how things are going. I find the rulebook was a little verbose for how much information you actually need to get out of it versus how much information is presented. It's clear, to be clear, but at the same time, just significantly longer than I think it perhaps needed to be. I'm not saying this is someone who looked through it in terms of trying to cut things down. I just felt the rulebook went on for a lot longer than the actual amount of information you get out of the game. Like I said already though, teaching's fairly easy. The playtime is a little accessible, although I am going to strongly nitpick around how the dice work in this game. You see, you have a bunch of dice over here, and the playtime for this game, for context, can run anywhere between 30 to 60 minutes, but I would say this game can actually easily be a 20 to 25 minute game consistently time and time again if you were rolling dice simultaneously. You see, the game basically has players taking their turns one at a time, executing on their dice. There's a limited number of dice in the game, and then I take my turn, I roll my dice, I go through the system, I try to make decisions, and then you, and onwards and so forth. That's great for your first two or three experiences as you try to teach other players and get a sense of teamwork and problem solving. But practically speaking, a few extra dice could make this game be just as good, but just be significantly faster as players roll through their turns simultaneously. So I hope they offer this as some sort of additional add-on pack. I mean, if they're not going to include it in the game, I'd love to have this as an add-on pack where you can buy extra dice, because really, Mega Man Adventures, skipping to the review part, it's a solid, solid game. I just wish it were significantly quicker, because I just think it's the same. Dropping dice all over the floor. I think it's the same game system, just I want more dice is what I'm saying over there. Table space is not so bad. I'm a little bit crammed over here trying to get into the camera shot, but table space, not so bad. So for the most part, a little bit of nitpicking about the rules, and I really, really want more dice. Past that, a fairly accessible experience to dive into. As far as player count, this is a 1 to 4 player experience. I have so far played it at 2, 3, and 4 players. I have not dived into the solo mode. At 2, 3, and 4, it works well. I mean, all those player counts, it works well. I will say 4 was my least favorite, but only because of that dice aspect. Again, past that, if we were playing simultaneously, 4 would have been just as good as 2 and 3. It would have been just more collaboration, more sense of trying to work with other players. But right now, because we're working with one set of dice, it is a little slower at the 4-player count. As far as interaction, Mega Man Adventures is incredibly interaction heavy as you sit there and collaborate with each other. You sit there, you start off the round by trying to think through, well, you need these colors, I need those colors, I'll give you this one over here which will potentially give you some damage but also help you with some skills over there. There's a lot of talking to each other as you figure out how to go things together. And then what I found is that once you start playing it as well, in addition to discarding the card to give people extra things, you often have a degree of problem solving together as you work through it, and it doesn't feel like alpha playing. Because the alpha player aspect, the idea of one player controlling the game and talking to other players through things, it depends on the group, I'm sure, but for us, it didn't feel like alpha playing. It felt like each player tried to solve their own puzzle, and then they find a moment where they got stuck, and they're like, ooh, how can I accomplish that particular phase? And someone would be like, well, what if you spend an energy to reroll that? What if you utilize your weapon? What if I give you this card, and then you do that? And we found that it was a very collaborative, interactive experience playing through the game. As far as what I liked, didn't like, and see others not liking, starting off with the characters and their abilities. Characters in general feel fairly different. Not the top parts of the cards, to be clear. The top parts, while there are differences to the decks, they mostly feel fairly samey. That's not entirely true. One of the characters actually has a degree of risk-reward to it. They feel different even at the top. I would say for the most part, though, the main differences start to be felt through the abilities on the bottom. That when you start cashing in your skills over there to get your unique upgrade or aspect there, the characters do feel and play a little differently as you go through it. The weapons, levels, bosses, and more give you a wide amount of variability to the experience. You have a giant stack full of weapons. I have them off to the side. You have a giant stack full of weapons you can get. There's also a bit of a campaign mode as you can go through things and earn weapons and whatever. There's also single shot. I've primarily played through this at single shot. So there's a whole stack full of weapons. There's a bunch of characters. There's a bunch of these stages to fully mix things up and give you a different challenge and puzzle every single time. Every single one of these stages, I mean, they don't feel that different, but they are different in terms of the specific way they give you a challenge to go through. There's a giant stack of bosses, and those stage changes, these Iceman and their way they change up the stages and give you the final boss. There's just a lot of content for this game. A lot of it follows the same general notes, so it's not necessarily as variable as all that, but a lot of different things going on over here. And the challenge system, like I said already, will give you reasons to dive into it again and again. As soon as you feel like you have a handle on how this works and how to work through your allocation and work together with your teammates, suddenly start throwing these into the mix and you will have a different puzzle, a different challenge to go through. Communication and teamwork are absolutely key in this game. The idea that you're not just playing your own solo little cooperative game, you're sharing things, you're sharing cards. And so you're going to be talking to each other, trying to figure out how you can best assist them, how they can best assist you, which gives this game a very collaborative feel to it. And then those boss fights feel like a solid challenge through the end of the game. I find most of the game you're trying to manage your health, trying to keep it high because you will need it doing those boss fights. Those boss fights are a little harder, as they should be, and that's where you'll find that you take the most hits as you play through things. So you're trying to basically stay alive as much as possible across two or three stages. Then you hit the boss mode, and you hope that you can make it through this stack of cards, because the stack of cards is going to be a little harder going through the boss, and yet you don't really get more to work with past maybe a few crates or energy or things you've picked up. But for the most part, you're going to take more hits during that boss battle. As far as things I didn't like in the experience, to begin with, I touched upon this already. Despite the wide variability of the game itself, the actual decision space doesn't change much game to game. The decision space doesn't change much no matter what weapons or stages or bosses you mix in. The decision space is basically the same exact concept of trying to figure out how you can allocate things, how you can work together, and it's going to be the same process of thinking through what you want to do no matter what you use to mix it up. Some of these stage cards will change that, so that is a possibility as far as mixing things up, but most of the other variability, while it's nice to have, doesn't change the core process you go through in the game as you figure out how to roll dice, how to allocate things, how to work together, and how to utilize your skills and your buffs and all that stuff to try to make it through alive. Secondly, I'll say that having the death system in the game, the way it works, where you can die and then you have a limited number of deaths, feels a bit anticlimactic. It works from a balance standpoint, it works in terms of the actual game system, but dying and then getting your free life, and it's true to the video game in general, or the concept, but dying and getting a free life feels a little bit anticlimactic as you sit there and you're like, oh, well, now I'm dead. I wasn't able to keep myself alive. Good news is we have another free life left, and you can use that to modulate the game difficulty as well, by the way, the number of free lives you get. So, I mean, it works. It just doesn't feel great to die, and then you still win the game because you had a free life. So I almost wish the characters just had more life, or there was some other system. The idea that you can get a free death just feels a bit anticlimactic and feels a bit less like you actually won. I mean, we'll still take the win, but it feels a bit less like it. As far as what I can see, others not liking. First of all, it is a bit of a lighter experience. A lighter is not necessarily inherently a bad thing, but just understand walking in, this is a game where you're rolling dice and assigning things together. It is not easy. To be very clear, it's not easy, especially as you mix these in. You will have to struggle to survive, but the core gameplay decisions are on the lighter side, all things considered. Secondly, lots of luck in the dice rolling. This is a game where you have to make decisions around what works for you. But at the end of the day, if things don't roll your way, or if things do roll your way, you will have an easier or harder decision just based on the amount of times you'll be rolling your dice trying to get through these stages. So if, while there's a lot of tactical planning and teamwork and thinking through and utilizing your abilities, there's also a lot of rolling your dice and seeing whether you get doubles or seeing whether you get the right symbols and just seeing if things just happen to go your way or really, really, really not go your way as you're going through the game. As far as final thoughts on Mega Man Adventures, something I probably should have said at the beginning is I'm not familiar with the IP at all. I mean, I'm not familiar. I know the Mega Man games. I just never grew up with them. I never really played them. I'm not attached to this IP, so I'm not biased towards the game from that stance. If anything, I tend to find any sort of Nintendo-esque visual design something that doesn't pull me in. I'm a PC gamer, and my fondest memories of PC gaming are not, older graphics. They're more newer stuff for the most part, so I'm not really pulled in by that kind of game system. But I find Mega Man Adventures compelling. I like the sense of what it's doing. This is a system that I've liked in Marvel United, the general idea of teamwork as you try to figure out how to play cards together and work with each other. It's a system that I liked about Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, the idea of trying to share your dice or share your abilities with players on the right or the left. And it's a system that I like in Mega Man Adventures. The game is light, but it's simple, it's compelling, it gives you a reason to dive into it, and it feels rewarding to get through one stage after the next, and then eventually face down that boss and take them out. The overall gameplay can feel a little samey as you go through it, but the challenges mix things up a bit, and the general puzzle of just trying to stay alive as you figure out how to help each other, how to work with each other as you go through things, is compelling. For right now, this is a 4-5 for me. Now, I do wonder how this holds up over time. Going back to my Marvel United comparison a second ago, at the end of the day, Marvel United is a game that I really like, but it is a game that the IP, my attachment to Marvel, has definitely kept that one fresh over time, as I'm happy to dive in with more characters I know and like. Versus with Mega Man Adventures, I don't particularly know or care about these characters. I'm not emotionally attached to them, and so I do wonder the lighter gameplay, how it holds up for me over time as I continue to dive into it. For right now, like I said already, 4-5, really enjoying this one. As far as other game recommendations, I touched upon them already, but I'm going to be going with Marvel United and Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles City Fall. Both those games are giving you very different experiences, but very heavily leaning into the cooperative gameplay and the sense of teamwork that you'll get as you work together to go through a difficult experience that you'll need each other's help to make your way out of alive. Hope you found this review helpful. Until next time, I'm Alex Radcliffe from Board Game Co., and I hope you have a good one.